Hey, hi there, and welcome to another episode of Sit and Spin with Joe, me, your host, Joe Royland. Kind of a sad one today. Still reeling from yesterday's news of the unexpected tragic death of Chris Cornell, lead singer from Soundgarden, Temple of Dog, Audioslave. But today, I was originally going to do a whole other record because I'm still behind on getting caught up on some stuff, but it just so happens that today was the reissue of the 25th anniversary edition of the singles soundtrack. First time it's ever been out on vinyl. Came in a deluxe edition, two album vinyl set, has this nice gatefold cover on the inside. Also came with a bonus CD of previously unreleased material and a download of the album. We're going to get to a little bit more details on all that in just a second, but Chris Cornell played a very essential part in this, and we're going to get into some of that in just a minute too. But singles, if you, I don't know how you've never seen that movie by now, because it's been out for 25 years and it's a great flick. It is a Cameron Crowe directed and written movie, his kind of, his love letter to the Seattle scene. And we talked about that movie back in episode 87 when it got its Blu-ray release on the first time, and all the way back in episode 4, part 1, when we discussed the top 10 rock and roll and or music movies. You can go back and check those out to get more information on the movie itself. We're going to be focusing more on the soundtrack today. Now, the movie came out in September of 1991. However, the soundtrack, in a very, very rare occurrence, was actually rush released several months ahead of the album. It came out in June, and that was because it was to help capitalize on the breaking Seattle grunge sound movement that was happening at the time. And because this soundtrack featured several of the hot artists from that scene, including Alice in Chains, who stopped by in the album with the track Wood, Pearl Jam, of course, with two non-album tracks, Breathe and State of Love and Trust, which also just got released as a limited edition single this past record store day. I didn't pick it up because it just kind of seemed like overkill getting them again on this record. You may have. The Screaming Trees' Nearly Lost You, which came out actually ahead of their album, Sweet Oblivion. Mudhoney and the song Overblown, and of course Soundgarden with the track Birth Ritual, and Chris Cornell solo himself, the song you're hearing right now, the melancholy acoustic Seasons, which is one of my all-time favorite songs from Chris Cornell. It was actually my favorite track, aside from the Pearl Jam tracks, on this record. And Chris had this habit of releasing great songs not on any of his album propers, but only on soundtracks to movies. Aside from this one, there's also the song Sunshower from the soundtrack to the movie Great Expectations. Neither of those tracks are on any of his records, and it's just a shame. But back to this record, aside from the hot acts of the time, there were also some other past Seattle bands, or you could look at a band like Mother Love Bone, pre-Pearl Jam, who show up with the song Chloe Dancer, Crown of Thorns. Of course, they kind of just predated the whole Seattle scene a little bit, but at the time this movie was being made, like Andrew Wood just died a year before, and Pearl Jam had just come into existence. Anna and Nancy Wilson of Heart, Seattle band, who Nancy Wilson, of course, was Cameron Crowe's wife at the time of this, and they show up here on the side project Love Mongers, covering Led Zeppelin's Battle of Evermore, and Jimi Hendrix, who a lot of people tend to forget is from Seattle as well, chimes in with They This Be Love. Now, of course, there was also a couple of other popular artists around there. Smashing Pumpkins show up with the song Drown. They were breaking at that time. And, of course, Paul Westerberg from The Replacements, nearby neighboring Minneapolis, Minnesota, he shows up with two solo tracks before he'd even put a solo album out. The Great Dyslexic Heart and Waiting for Somebody are on this album. Couldn't get those. Now, the fact that most of these songs weren't available anywhere else also helped drive this album's sales to double platinum status and the top 10 of the album charts. And it was, in fact, the first big-selling soundtrack of the 90s decade. Now, the bonus material featured here is pretty much all the other music that was in the film that didn't make it onto the soundtrack proper. Would have ended up being a two CD set back then. And this includes live tracks and demos from Alice in Chains, tracks like It Ain't Like That Live, as well as a live version of Wood. I love the live version of It Ain't Like That from the movie. Soundgarden, also a live or demo version of Birth Ritual, Mudhoney, and there's a couple of songs from other artists that didn't make it onto the soundtrack, Truly Stopped By with Blood and Lungs, Blood Circus with 6 Feet Under, and of course, Citizen Dick, the made-up band for the movie, which was comprised of Matt Dillon and Pearl Jam members Eddie Vedder, Jeff Ament, and Stone Gossard. Now, They do the song Touch Me, I'm Dick, which prior to this deluxe edition coming out was only released 2 years back on Record Store Day on this limited edition 45. So it's cool that it's available now on a different format. And aside from that, though, what I was really jazzed about for the unreleased stuff on this stuff was the incidental score music from Paul Westerberg, Mike McCready from Pearl Jam, and of course Chris Cornell. Most of these songs aren't that long, it's just a little incidental stuff, but it was the kind of stuff I was really jazzed about adding to my collection. And there are actually early working demos of Spoon Man and Flutter Girl, songs that wouldn't turn up till much later on, or a couple years later, at least in the case of Soundgarden, and with Chris Cornell off his album. So it's cool to actually have those on here. Now, it's a shame that couldn't have been on vinyl, because when this project was originally announced back, I think, in January, that's what the plan was. It was supposed to be a 3-LP vinyl set, but somewhere along the line, it changed to just being a 2-LP set of the original soundtrack and then just including the bonus stuff on a CD. But at least we have it on CD and not just digital download, which is cool. But I think what probably happened, and this is just my educated guess, is that there is such a glut and a backlog of producing vinyl these days that they just would not have been able to get it mastered for vinyl and put out as the vinyl release in time. It probably would have taken a lot longer for that to happen. They wanted to get this album out closer to the actual release date. And as it is now, it's coming maybe a month ahead of what it would have been. And it probably would have taken much longer, and it may not have actually made it still being the 25th anniversary release of the film. So they did it this way, but again, you know, I'd rather have it on CD than nothing, or just a digital download. I'm not a super huge fan of those. It's great when they have it, but I'd rather either have the vinyl or the CD. Now, of course, the big bummer, as we previously stated, is that this is kind of marred because of Chris's passing, and no one knew that was going to happen, though. Chris was such an amazing artist, been a big fan of his, although admittedly, I wasn't at the start. Truth be told, I didn't really discover the band until their major label debut, Louder Than Love, and while I liked a couple songs off that, I just thought he was too much of a screamer and not enough of a singer, but, you know, the guy was just so talented. He had, was a multi-instrumentalist, great songwriter, had a 4-octave powerful voice, and he was most known for that belting style and the fact that he could scream songs out, but as he would prove, he also had a nice gentler side, and it wasn't until the Temple of the Dog album that I really realized, hey, this guy can actually sing too, and truly, truly started to appreciate him. Of course, we covered Pearl Jam's, Temple of the Dog's 25th anniversary release in last year's episode number 126. You can go back and check that out. And there have also been Soundgarden release, the 25th anniversary of Bad Motorfinger, which came out in 1991 originally. That's been reissued on vinyl, came out as a CD and a box set deluxe edition, much like Temple of the Dog. And most of Soundgarden's A&M catalog has been reissued on vinyl in the last 6 months or so. You can go and check those things out if you don't have them. Now, Chris, of course, had a lot of success with Soundgarden after they finally broke with Bad Motorfinger. And when the band, I don't know if they necessarily ever broke up, but they definitely went on a hiatus because they did get back together again. But in the interim, his next big project would be the band Audioslave with former members of Rage Against the Machine. They did 3 albums together. And also during this time, Chris also maintained a solo career. And over the years, he released the albums Euphoria Morning in 1999, Carry On in 2007, Scream, the much maligned Timbaland produced album from 2009, the live acoustic songbook in 2011, and his final album in 2015, Higher Truth. Now, this was a record that I originally wanted to review, just never kind of got around to it. It kind of got lost in the mad, chaotic, crazy rush of the impending arrival, birth, and aftermath of my son Malcolm, where everything just got really crazy and I pretty much took off almost 2 months of doing shows because of that. And so much time had passed that I just never got around to doing it. So consider this a little bit of a makeup for that then, but Chris Cornell's Higher Truth album is actually probably my favorite solo album overall of all of his stuff. It is mostly acoustic driven, and that's the kind of stuff I really dug from him. A lot of great tunes. The first single, Nearly Forgot My Broken Heart, the songs Dead Wishes, which I featured on the page yesterday, Only These Words, Worried Man, Before We Disappear, all great stuff. There was a deluxe edition CD that featured 4 extra bonus tracks. And the vinyl, what's nice about that is it actually includes those as part of it as well. And 2 of those songs are exceptional as well, including Wrong Side and Misery Chain. But it's a shame that this is probably going to be some of the last music we ever get from Chris. There might be some other stuff in the can, I'm sure. He was pretty for life a guy. Seemed to have a lot of stuff going on, and it's that's why it was such a shock that he died. Speculation and what they're saying the cause of death was is suicide, although his wife is kind of contesting that. But she did say that he had been on anti-anxiety medication because he's been so busy with a lot of things. He did Pearl Jam reunion shows last year and early into this year. He's been back on tour with Soundgarden just the night before he died. Just did a show that night. And there were talks of a new Soundgarden album coming out. And I don't know why, but you know, you take too much anti-anxiety medication, and one of the tragic side effects of that is it can lead to suicidal thoughts. Whether that's what happened or not, that's just speculation. We don't know. I don't think there's a note. I don't think we're ever going to know. But it's a great tragedy that we're no longer going to have Chris Cornell around in our life. Now, you factor in all the really successful singers from the grunge era, and there's only one left now. Eddie Vedder is the last man standing. Layne Staley, Alice in Chains, gone. Eddie Wood, Mother Love Bone, gone. Chris Cornell, now gone. And some people would even include Scott Weiland from Stone Temple Pilots in that. I don't really think they were grunge. They just kind of got associated with that moment. But if you want to include him in there too, he's gone as well. That leaves Eddie Vedder, who hopefully will be around with us for a lot longer. But that's it. I'm starting to get misty here, so I'm going to cut this short now, and it's already run pretty long. But that's our show this week. Rest in peace, Chris Cornell. Hopefully, wherever you're at now, you're finding the peace that maybe you didn't think you had here. At least you left behind us a wealth of great material that we can wrap ourselves up in if we're ever feeling sad, and cheer us up again. So we will catch you next time on Sit and Spin, where we're getting around to some other things that I haven't gotten around to yet. And thanks for tuning in for this show, and we'll talk to you next time on Sit and Spin. See you later.